Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Between the Listening and the Telling, How Stories Can Save Us, by Mark Yaconelli. Foreword by Anne Lamott. Narrated by Noah Yaconelli. Foreword. Mark Yaconelli is an unusual person, as brilliant as he is plain-spoken. He is an activist and a homebody, a contemplative and a goofball, gentle in spirit and charismatic, funny, deeply articulate, and capable of both wonderful compassion and silliness. And he brings all these qualities to his new book. I cannot imagine there will ever be a more critical need for a book such as this than now. It is an exploration of storytelling as a path to the strength and vulnerability and connection we will so desperately need to survive and come through these times. It is a profound reflection on storytelling as the path to community identity and renewal for towns and cities and families who have experienced devastation. It is an account of his work teaching people how to make this transformative process available to others. It is an owner's manual for the soul. It is like no other book I've ever read. As we struggle with the realities of injustice and inequality, the consequences of the pandemic, and the greatest environmental catastrophe of history, Mark Yaconelli offers personal experiences, practical guidance, and stories of resurrection. In this time, like no other, we long for hope and connection. Yaconelli shows us the psychological, spiritual, and logistical underpinnings of his work as an organizer of community storytelling events. Towns and cities frequently summon him following disaster or humiliation, both long-term and immediate. By asking the right questions and listening to the answers, he helps people feel their humanity and worth again when these have been stripped away. He helps people cry and spew and laugh together, and the laughter is so subversive. These things heal us. Here he is in his own words. We map our world in story. The world falls apart. We map a new world. Again and again, we story our lives in order to situate ourselves. I am here, not there. I am here and long to go there. Once found, new possibilities emerge. Curiosity rises within us. We feel the pull to discover new countries, traverse new oceans. How do we even begin this process of transformation when we feel crushed and overwhelmed, totally lost, or existentially lonely? We show up. Mark has been convincing and tricking people into showing up to his workshops and retreats for decades. 20 years ago, I witnessed him at an evening workshop in which he got several dozen adults and teenagers to stand up, mill around, and bump into each other while muttering, "Mill, mill, mill." I milled, which is so not me, and came to know the secret, intimate places that my bumpies loved most in the world. And I told them mine. I have since taken that exercise along with me to dubious Sunday school classes and skeptical writing workshops, with great success, laughter, occasional tears, and new friendships. Through his work, Mark helps people begin to know themselves and their common values. He understands and teaches the great lesson. If people are going to be transformed, it has to come from love, from speaking to one another about the truth of what we have lived. Through the experiences and unique teaching ability he writes about so eloquently in his book, Mark shares the ways in which this truth-telling and trust become possible. Storytelling is truly an art, and Mark makes it available to all. No one has asked most people to tell their stories in depth. What it was like growing up as the child of an alcoholic or a refugee or a police officer. No one has asked most people where they hid as a child or when their parent could really see them. Telling our stories to someone who is really listening offers us the experience of being seen, of being felt, as in, I feel you. I feel your heart. Can you feel mine? Can you feel the warmth of my caring? Now more than ever, as we struggle out of deep fear and isolation, We need a teacher and a book such as this. Anyone who works with groups of people who are hurting or seeking in neighborhoods or colleges, churches or prisons, migrant camps, or struggling organizations will be shown how story can become a source of sustenance and healing. Writer Colin McCann says that storytelling is the great democracy, and Mark teaches us how we might be citizens of this beautiful concept. He shows us how to leave the silos of our own points of view, the two-dimensional stuckness of our analytical prisons, and enter into the shared human experiences of connection. Anger and laughter shared, fear and joy passed back and forth. This builds compassion, and this decreases our loneliness. We can breathe differently because sharing and listening bring expansion and even, in Mark's telling, wonder and homecoming. And these bring hope. Over and over in this book, you will see people move from fear and powerlessness to strength and renewal. You will see people feeling doomed and misunderstood, experience those first glimmers of belief in each other, in life, and, hardest of all, in themselves again. Mark teaches us how and why storytelling has been the collagen of communities since someone in the first cave communities invited others to come sit by the fire, under the moon, and listen to their shared stories. Almost all humans prefer stories about themselves, I know I do. It is through this communion, between the listening and the telling, letting ourselves be seen and heard and acknowledged, that we come to the great, longed-for understanding of why we are here, who we are, what really matters, and that we, in fact, matter. This is the ultimate liberation. This book is a joyful compass toward both freedom and unity. If this is too hard to imagine, just keep listening and begin the journey yourself. You'll find a mesmerizing tour guide in Mark Yaconelli. And be sure to buckle up. Finding your way home can be a wild ride, one you may have waited a lifetime to begin. Anne Lamott, New York Times bestselling author of Help Thanks Wow, Bird by Bird, and Dusk Night Dawn. Chapter 1, A Place the Soul Once Knew. There are moments, often unexpected, when you find yourself at home in your own life. Simple, gentle, ordinary moments. Standing at the kitchen window. Rain outside. The earth springing into green and yellow. The birds, the ridiculous birds, singing without worry beneath the gray sky. For some reason, without effort, the anxiety lifts, your chest relaxes, your senses awaken, a quiet descends, and you are home. It is in moments like this when I can feel how distant I have been from the life I long to live. I've been homesick and didn't know it. I've been living miles away from my deepest yearnings and not known it. I have been hurrying through my days, isolated, fragmented, caught within the jet stream of the anxious world. Only now, in the waking stupor, do I feel the alienation and loss and, like a sobering drunk, ask, how long was I out? Months is the reply. Other times, years. I used to sometimes sense in conversations with friends, in the movies, books, and stories we consumed, an unspoken longing for some kind of great disruption, a disaster, an upheaval, some systemic breakdown, cell towers toppled, the internet shorted out, highways blocked, the human world forced to stop. It was a fantasy, of course, but one that revealed a kind of helpless despair at the lives we find ourselves compelled to live. It came from an unconscious understanding that our way of life was destructive and unsustainable, dishonest and unsatisfying. A longing for a reckoning and repentance. A longing for limits, for an adult in the room to say, that is enough. It was a longing for someone to end the tyranny of our every impulse. A longing that we might come to our senses, to our neighbors, to our own basic needs and gifts. And then the world stopped. The pandemic hit, and we were effectively put under house arrest. Masked and hand sanitized, we peered with suspicion behind locked doors at the mail carrier, the old couple walking their dog far too casually, our own mother returning a casserole dish. "Step back, mother. Do not touch the doorknob. Just leave it on the doorstep, mother." The Grim Reaper chillingly made its way through the human population, compelling all of us to not only withdraw from public spaces, but also to reflect inwardly. What is the meaning of life? What matters? Why am I living this way? Why have I wasted so much time? The pandemic ushered us into a liminal space, a disorienting, perilous state of unknowing, where we had to confront our relationship to self, others, technology, the past, the earth, the sacred. A period when everything unhealed within us was dredged to the surface, and it became unquestionably clear that the old stories of mindless consumerism, environmental exploitation, economic inequality, white body supremacy were killing us. Like a rite of passage or a well-crafted story, the pandemic carried us into a state of disorder, which all wisdom traditions believe is a necessary stage for transformation. Order, disorder, reorder. The gift of this disruption has been the uncovering of our fundamental cravings for one another, for the natural world, for family, for rest, for healing, for reconciling the divisions the old stories have kept alive. Several years ago, I spent 6 months living and working in northern Wales. It is a rural, ancient land, layered in stories and history. The Welsh people have struggled and suffered to keep their language and, through that language, a connection to the past, to their ancestors, to the land itself. Within that language, there is a sacred Welsh word, a word, the Welsh tell me, that doesn't quite translate into English. The word is hiraeth. A wise friend from that land once told me the word refers to a particular kind of longing. "What kind of longing?" I asked. He paused, trying to find the words. "A longing for a place or time that the soul once knew." My son Noah was living in London. He was studying acting, living in an apartment with a handful of American students from across the United States. I called and asked how he was getting along with his roommates. He told me it wasn't easy to connect to the other students because they spent much of their time by themselves, on their phones, on social media. When they did socialize with one another, it often involved heavy drinking. Then he said, "They are all full of longing. But they don't know what they're longing for. They don't even know they're longing." He could have been describing most of us in the West, overwhelmed, estranged from our lives, out of touch with our inner vitality. We often find ourselves entranced by activities we know are empty and damaging. We are longing but don't know why. We are yearning for a life we once knew, but we can't seem to remember where we left it. 2 weeks later, I called Noah and asked how it was going. He told me he invited his roommates to go with him to a farmer's market. Together, they bought chicken and vegetables, apples, lemons, and fresh herbs. They spent the rest of the day cooking: a fall soup, garlic potatoes, beet salad, roast chicken with rosemary and lemon, apples baked in butter and cinnamon. Eager to share the feast they had made, Noah and his roommates called the students from the apartment next door and invited them over. They lit candles, gathered leaves and flowers for the table. When the guests arrived, Noah asked everyone to set their phones aside. "We took our time," he told me. "We sat at the table for hours just talking, telling stories about our families, the towns we grew up in, our hopes for the future." He paused. "We sat late into the night, until early morning, just talking. Everyone was so tired, but no one wanted to leave." Although he didn't say it, my guess is that around that table, the longing momentarily ceased. The emptiness filled. The anxiety calmed. Within those hours rich with story and laughter and human warmth, 8 university students found home. What does it mean to be human? How are we to spend our days? How do we face the troubles of this world? How do we address the heartache for the life we're meant to live but can't remember how? How do we find the place that the soul once knew? In another time, in another setting, sitting together around a table and sharing stories was as necessary to human life as bread and water. Storytelling was our source of identity, connecting us to our passions, our daily work, the people we encountered, the land we inhabited. Sharing stories was a kind of communion, a shared meal, inviting others to be nourished by what we had lived, suffered, and overcome. Telling stories kept our core values vibrant and accessible, drew to the surface our most generous and courageous qualities. Sitting with friends, long into the evening, trading stories back and forth, this was how we cultivated the wonder of living and the pleasure of human companionship. Sharing our experiences face to face gave our lives, no matter how mundane, a sense of value and worth. We are relational beings. We need others in order to become ourselves. We need relationship to access the deepest gifts of our humanity. We need relationships to live lives that are productive, loving, and meaningful. Sharing stories is how we make a home within ourselves and one another. Story is how we put together the broken pieces. Story is how we identify and heal the suffering within and among us. The practice of storytelling, particularly when sharing the real stories from our own living, tethers us to what matters most: our families, our friends, nature, the hearts we carry, the wondrous mystery of life itself. Every human being longs for a good question and a listening ear. Where did you like to hide as a child? When was a time you felt deeply betrayed? Where was the place that most felt like home? Who was the love that got away? How did you find yourself in this town? When was the last time you felt truly alive? When my brother Trent's best friend, Eric, died in a military helicopter accident at age 20, my father asked him to gather Eric's friends at our home. My father was a volunteer pastor, what he jokingly called a Kmart pastor, since he'd never been to seminary. But he was a good communicator and well-loved in our small town. So when there was a death, either among the little congregation that he served or among people in town who had no religious affiliation, he was often the one asked to do the funeral. I had attended a few funerals led by my dad, but had never watched his process. That wintry February evening in a room full of hurting, disoriented young adults, I watched my dad draw out stories from each of us. Tell me a story about Eric. Did you and Eric ever get into trouble? What was he like when he had a crush on a girl? What did he do that annoyed you? Tell me a memory of Eric that makes you laugh. The writer Isaac Dennison once said, "All sorrows can be born if you put them into a story or tell a story about them." That evening, as we told stories that made us laugh, cry, or go silent in wonder, the grief and heartache found release. Over time, the stories we crafted that evening, the stories that my father retold at the funeral, became meeting places where Eric could be encountered, his life felt, his gifts received, his friendship still present. A few years later, Robert, the brother of a good friend of mine, passed away suddenly. I was in my late 20s and working as a youth minister at a Presbyterian church. My friend Harold called and asked if I would do the funeral. I had no experience officiating a funeral or any public gathering of any significance, but how could I refuse my friend? I called my dad and asked him what to do. Since he was a minister, I assumed he would offer me a sermon outline. But my dad also knew that most sermons, particularly in a time of grief, can be alienating and abstract. His advice was to gather the stories. "Tell the stories that help people feel Robert's life," he told me. "Get people together. Ask good questions that help them remember and form stories about their life with him. Draw out the memories, and then listen and take notes on the stories they tell. That's what's needed. Any meaning, any hope, Any truths that need to be spoken will come from there. Without having to wait for a funeral, how do we make contact with the power of the stories we embody, the stories planted within us, the life-giving stories that dwell between us? How can we access stories in ways that are sacred and purposeful? The space matters. The listening matters. The telling matters. It matters where you are, who is in the room, the place in your heart from which the story is told. 1 year into the pandemic, the brand new Phoenix High School has opened for in-person classes. Many of the students enrolled in this small Southern Oregon school are traumatized, not only because of coronavirus anxiety and social isolation, but also because 6 months earlier, the Almeda wildfire burned much of the region to the ground. More than 3,500 homes and businesses were destroyed, and approximately 5,000 people were displaced. After disinfecting our hands and signing the requisite contact tracing form, my colleague Erica and I are escorted to Mr. Roderick's classroom. His afternoon class is titled, How to Become a Better Human Being. The classroom is watched over by large profile posters of American saints: Martin Luther King Jr., Cesar Chavez, Helen Keller, Rosa Parks, Abraham Lincoln. Erica and I stand self-consciously in front of the 9 students, who look like enormous cockatoos in their white-beaked breathing masks. We have been asked by the Oregon Health Authority to help students share stories as a way to reduce anxiety and depression. In My Grandmother's Hands, therapist and author Rezma Menakem depicts trauma as a wordless story our body tells itself about what is safe and what is a threat. The work, according to Menakem, is to metabolize our pain. Sitting in circles, listening compassionately to one another, is one way we can digest our suffering and activate our capacity to heal. I diagram a few story patterns on the whiteboard. I talk about how most stories present a conflict, a problem, a difficulty. This has been a year of immense difficulty. We ask the students to write a personal story about a struggle they have faced this past year. Describe life before and during the struggle. Where are you in the story now? The teacher passes out materials. The students go inward. The quiet scratching of pens on paper feels intimate. After 10 minutes, we sit in a large circle and the students read what they've written. They are stories of loss, of isolation, self-judgment, unending worry, of carrying the pain of their parents. When the sharing ends, we ask, what was it like to exchange stories? A broad-shouldered youth with a Seattle Seahawks jersey raises his hand. Joyful, he says. Joyful, I repeat, somewhat surprised. Yeah. Even though everyone's depressed, I could feel myself in each person's story, and that's joyful. This is how stories can save us. We step into the reality of another person's existence, and instead of judgment, feel kinship. When we say, tell me your story, we're really asking, can I relive your experience with you? Can I try and see as you have seen, feel as you have felt, know the world as you have known it? The honest listening and telling of personal experiences naturally endears us to one another. The illusion of separateness dissipates, and we see ourselves in one another's story. When that happens, we are no longer able to demonize, ridicule, oppress, or neglect the other. This is not rocket science. This capacity is a natural, hardwired human inclination that anyone can engage. And when we do, we can heal our families, our world, and ourselves. One afternoon, sitting by the stone fireplace in a farmhouse just outside the Welsh-speaking town of Bala, I listen as 72-year-old Dorothy Magdalene Evans tells her granddaughter about the house we are in. This hearth was built by your great-great-grandfather. He made it by hand using stones he hauled up from the little creek just down the way. Your grandfather was raised in this home, and when he grew up, he built this kitchen and your parents' bedroom. Do you see those beams overhead? They are from the trees he cut on this land. Your grandfather lived here too when he was little, just like you. And when he grew up, we moved into this house. She pauses, then continues. We raised your mother in this home. She used to play hide-and-seek down in the basement, just like you do. We added the upstairs bedrooms for your mother and her brothers, also using wood from the trees on this land. And now you and your brothers sleep in those same rooms and help with the lambing just as your mother did, just as your grandfather did when he was your age. Sitting there that afternoon, I basked in the light of Dorothy's stories, warming myself by the fire as she passed on to her granddaughter the stories she had gathered from her life. Like rich and nourishing food, Dorothy told story after story, feeding her granddaughter history, identity, and connection to the past, her relatives, the land, her own origin. I watched as the young girl's soul gathered in her grandmother's words and presence. These stories will be the roots of a meaningful life. These stories will become a home no matter where the young girl's life leads. Even if she grows up and moves to New York City to become a stockbroker, she will always carry that sense of relationship, that sense of home. She will carry that knowledge through the stories she has been told, through the stories she has lived, through the stories she tends within her. One day she may fall in love, and in the intimacy of that relationship, share her story, her identity, the heart of who she is. When I was a little girl, I lived in a farmhouse built by my great-grandfather in the north of Wales. Where are the hearths, the dinner tables, the kitchens where we are invited to share the stories that come from the root of our living? When will someone invite us to share the stories that connect us to what matters most? The stories that bring deep laughter, the stories that dissipate the loneliness, the stories that excavate and heal the injustices we've suffered, the stories that give our lives meaning and purpose, the stories that raise within us a quiet gratitude at the painful wonder of it all. This book is a reflection on the nature of stories within our individual and collective lives. The writing is based on decades of working with individuals, communities, and their lived stories. I've spent thousands of hours listening to people as they sifted through the chaotic laundry of their lives, working to make meaning, struggling to express their stories. In my work with the Hearth nonprofit, I help people tell stories in order to find acceptance, grieve loss, deepen friendships, strengthen families, shed light on an injustice, dispel an oppressive stereotype, celebrate the wonder of being alive. I've sat and listened to healthcare workers, combat veterans, environmental scientists, abuse survivors, refugees, farmers, educators, stay-at-home parents, college students, the terminally ill, faith leaders, incarcerated people, social justice activists, people from all walks of life with diverse economic, social, racial, and ethnic backgrounds. For years, I did this work solely for the Hearth, drawing out stories, creating spaces for people to narrate what they'd lived. And then word spread, and I began to get calls from outside my community. Combat veterans asking for help in sharing stories no one wanted them to tell. A youth shelter hoping I could draw forth stories from the LGBTQ community. A graduate school looking to create a space where people of color could exchange stories about their experiences of race. A hospice doctor asking for help communicating stories of death and grief, a city manager needing stories to soothe political tensions, an environmentalist seeking to gather stories to preserve an estuary. In all my careful listening, I've observed how speaking our stories can liberate us individually and collectively, at times transforming residents into neighbors, enemies into friends, and towns into communities. In doing this work, it has become apparent to me that the power of story is the power of relationships. In other words, giving testament to our experience generates meaning when it connects us to people, the earth, the sacred, our pasts, our own inner gifts and wounds. Through this work, I've come to believe that all human divisions, both within and between us, can begin to be healed through listening and sharing stories. This book seeks to share some of the ways I've witnessed healing take place. In a disconnected age, an age of runaway loneliness, I believe it is story that can transform us. Each chapter offers reflections on our private and public relationships. Chapters 1 through 3 focus more on the individual and the way we become estranged or empowered by the stories we carry. The later chapters tend to focus more on our shared lives, the way story can connect, engage, inspire, and mobilize for the common good. Throughout the book, there are story interludes that offer a respite from the discussion of stories. These interludes, true stories from my own network of relationships, function like pieces of music, inviting the reader to feel the meaning of the preceding chapters without having to define it. Ultimately, this book is about the soul of storytelling and the recovery of that natural, accessible, medicinal power that waits within every person, within every community.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.